is This Week in Perspective with me, Adam Simbe. The British people have spoken, that is, the UK, to leave the European Union in a referendum which was done on the 23rd of June. After 50 years or more than that, when they joined in 1973. The leave campaign got, of course, 52%, and the stay in got 48%. So the margins were very different here. But Britain, being a member of the Commonwealth of Nations, like we are in Tanzania, what will happen to Tanzania? And indeed, the East African region, SADC and COMESA, when finally Britain leaves the European Union. But that will subject to Britain evoking Article 50 of the Union, which starts the process. To discuss this, Britain leaving the European Union as a result of the referendum with me, today are on my left, Dr. Bohela Lunogelo, who's an economic and social analyst, Professor Mwesiga Baregu, is a political scientist from St. Augustine University, formerly, of course, University of Islam. Then, Professor Honest Prosper Ngoyi from the Mzumbe University Business School in Dar es Salaam campus. Last but not least, Richard Mgamba, who is a senior journalist and a managing director of the Guardian Limited. Welcome, gentlemen, to the program.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I hope we'll do justice to the program. Okay. Before we start, let me apologize, viewers. All efforts to try and balance this discussion with the British Tanzania Association, which exists, was not successful. We tried to get somebody representing the British business group again, not successful. Now was I successful in getting somebody from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Nonetheless, the four gentlemen here, we do justice to the program, and I'm sure the viewers will learn quite a lot, a great deal from these four gentlemen. So, gentlemen, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me start with Professor Baregu, and then we'll go around. What are the implications, if any, Professor Baregu, of Britain leaving the European Union to Tanzania, and to the region, the East African Community, SADC, and COMESA?
Maybe just before that, on implications for Tanzania, I think, why did Britain decide to have this vote and then vote to exit the European Union? And I think we should realize that Britain has always been the black sheep of the European family. They joined, as you said, only in 73, and found that the Union had been going ever since the end of the Second World War. And they were never really fully there. You know, they're not part of the currency.
Mm-hmm. No, area, the
Euro currency, they're not part of Schengen. So Britain has always had one foot in and one foot out. And that is partly because, I think, of the imperial hangover. That Britain, you know, is still, and if you look at the votes and the way they went, yeah. The older generation voting to exit and the younger generation voting to stay. So the older generation has that hangover, you know, rule Britannia, Britannia rule the waves, and the sun never sets on the British Empire. And I think they feel uncomfortable in a group of other people, which tends to lean towards equality among nations. I think that's part of the problem.
But for the older people, sorry, Professor,
yes.
Should have been more for staying in because of the experience of the Second World War.
No, I said it's the hangover.
All right.
And probably the memories of the Second World War may also be fading, which could have dire consequences for everybody if people forget why the Union was formed in the first place. Because basically it was a security organization to assure Europe that there won't be another war like happened in the Second World War. During the Second World War. But what is the impact on Tanzania? I think it will depend on, much will depend on how Tanzania response to this, and to what extent are we ready or prepared to see this kind of consequence? Because I think we should always have known that Britain is not really, was not a very stable partner of the European Union. But having said that, I think it's important that Tanzania itself has a strategy, and I don't know the extent to which we are really dependent on Britain alone and the extent to which we are dependent on the European Union. I think over the last few years, the European Union as a union, I think, has been featuring much more. Mm-hmm. If you talk about the aid relationships, etc. Mm-hmm. I'm not for aid myself, but to the extent that may be an effect, yeah. I don't think that it's going to affect very much if Tanzania maintains the relationship that it has had with the European Union.
Okay.
But much will depend. In the business area, it may be, because Britain is highly invested in Tanzania. Mm. But I don't think that the business part of Britain and the business community, if you saw the way London voted to stay, I don't think the British, the business community is going to respond to exit Europe, partly because of their interests. I don't think they can.
Professor Ngoyi, you've written so much about this in the last few weeks. Do you want the viewers to share some of your thoughts with the viewers today?
Yeah. Thank you. Partly as Professor Barego has said, to me, my point of departure is UK moving outside the EU as a single market. And now what it implied for UK staying in the single market. Now, when you move outside the single market, essentially, the country stands to lose. And now when it stands to lose, those who are dependent on it also stand to lose. So my point of departure is Tanzania stands to lose in terms of trade. And of course, trade here also include tourism, but also in terms of aid. The professor is not for aid, but of course, again, to some extent, Tanzania depends on aid from Britain. But also really, partly, to a small extent, in terms of remittances. This is a country whose sons and daughters in the diaspora include some who are in Britain. Now, what may happen is when the UK is outside the single market, first of all, there is now, you know, when you're in the single market, you enjoy free movement of labor, capital, mm-hmm. people, free movement of goods and services. And now, this now kind of makes the British economy more prosperous, more, you know, now moving outside may, it has sent already shockwaves to the UK economy. Mm-hmm. The UK economy is likely to shrink, to collapse. Actually, we have seen what we call rating agencies. We have Fitch, we have Standard & Poor's, and a third one, it comes to my mind later, they have downgraded the UK economy because, again, of uncertainty. My last writing, I think I call it the uncertainty, the economics of uncertainty. When we aren't sure, when the captains and titans of the industry are not sure about tomorrow, and my tomorrow is not exactly today's date plus one, but then a month, some few years to come and all this, now there are shockwaves. There are shockwaves because partly, you know, remember that we are in one block, in one, this single market. Now, when you move, when you're outside the single market, what happens to the world of business, the corporate world, to the movers and shakers of the world of business is for them to continue accessing the UK market, I mean the EU market, it will be a problem. Yeah. Why? Because when we're outside, in order to access this market, first and foremost, you have to do it you have to jump what I call tariff and non-tariff barriers. Because once you are outside the single market, in order to export, let's say, UK now to export to Germany, to France and all this, they will now be outside what we call common external tariff. The EU, as is the case for East African Community, has what we call a common external tariff for those who are outside that union. So it will be difficult for these businesses to stay in UK. And so they are likely to exit. Actually, we have seen German car makers, or rather motor vehicle makers, say now we better move outside here because of this unpredictability.
Move outside the UK.
Outside the UK.
Particularly London, because London voted predominantly to remain.
Yeah. But also, again, along this, we have seen some companies reporting shares going down. Virgin Group and Richard. They have shown, not this Richard, the other Richard, they have shown really substantial, they have shown, the I think on that, within 1 week, his share dropped about a third of the worth of his company, losing almost 3,000 people. Now, with all those things, it will be difficult to see the UK economy remaining the way it is. And now, what does this mean to Tanzania? In terms of aid, You know, countries normally give between 0.5% to 1% of their gross domestic product as aid. So if the UK economy shrinks, now the 0.1% or 1%, even if it remains the same ratio, but then 0.1% of something that has shrunk is smaller than the whole sum. So that's how we can lose through aid. When it comes to investment, of course, now the financial markets where investors are going to borrow really are rather shaky. To extend loan to a British company that might have been thinking of coming and investing in this part of the world, it will be very expensive. You know, the cost of borrowing in a situation like this, because what we are seeing is likely to be economic crisis, the cost of borrowing will be high. And we have learned this from the 2008 global financial and economic crisis that started in the US. And then, you know, normally these crises tend to be contagious, you know. It will spread across the world. So maybe the last one is the question of remittances. Because somebody asked me, how is Tanzania going to be affected? Yes, we have our sons and daughters in the diaspora in UK. I think also you also have some of the friends, most of us have, you know, they are working there. But then if the UK economy shrinks, if businesses close, you know, what is going to happen is people will be losing jobs, some hours of working will be reduced, and even those whose working hours is not going to be reduced, they'll spend more cautiously. And this is the question of uncertainty. And so in this context, they won't be sending money back home as diasporans in terms of remittances. It may be a small amount, but for a country like Kenya, a country like Nigeria, a country like Pakistan, which receives more money from diasporan than even it receives from aid and trade, really, they may shake.
That's a problem. Richard, before I come to you. Yes, Richard.
I think there are two issues that we also need to understand. There were two camps campaigning, and in this campaign, you win or you lose. You can't get both. But the question here is, if you look at the way this question is, the implication, to me, I will go beyond the economics. This will also revive the extremism in countries like Tanzania, who have been calling for, you know, the union between Tanzania and Zanzibar. The East African community, where we have been so skeptical to join the common market and eventually have a federation government. Within the SADC region, where we are also talking about the same thing, you have SACU, Southern Africa Customs Union. We as Tanzanians, we are not part of SACU, though we are part of SADC. Recently, we saw South Africans negotiating about EPA, and then they signed without even considering members like Tanzania. Now, why do I say extremism? Remember, some few years back, there are people who believe the union between Tanzania and Zanzibar, we need a referendum to define it. Now, the question will be, if Britons can do it, why not we? Mm-hmm. Civilized, well-educated, they have a strong economy. The same with EAC. Because what is happening is you have the conservatives who believe that they have lost their country. They want their country back. And then you have the new generation, our generation, that want to live in a globalized world. Yes. So to me, what I see here is the UK has set a trend that will be used or cited as an example anywhere in the world.
You don't think that trend is unstoppable?
You can't stop it because, you know, we have that trend here. If we have to have free and fair voting system, believe me, there are people who will vote against the union, and there are those who will vote in favor of the union. Now, they will ask you this simple question. Fine, UK did it. Yes, there are losses. The Economist here has been analyzing. In any marriage, when there is a divorce, there will be cost. You will share that wealth with your wife whatever happens, the children and everybody. This was a union. And as my brother put it very well, UK has never been fully engaged within EU. If you understand, you have been in UK, some of you have lived there, their mentality. You know, they believe in what they call, we are the Britons.
It's island mentality, maybe. Yeah.
This is what we are.
Insularity, but also a measure of arrogance.
Yeah.
So at the end of the day, imperial arrogance.
At the end of the day, is for us in East African community, we need also to look at how we structure the so-called union. Because if you listen to the exit campaign, they are also questioning the bureaucracy in Brussels. Because the union is about the stomach. If these people have no, you know, they have no any means to get good job, Because they are telling you with your free immigration policy,
yes,
we have cheap labor coming from Eastern Europe, mm-hmm, coming here, taking our jobs. It's the same thing I hear in this country. Mm-hmm. You have waitress in the hotels from Kenya. Do you need waitress as expatriate in this country? So this question will be there. Mm-hmm. Because it is about the economy, nothing more. Yeah. When these people used to have a functioning health system, they believe it is not functioning because there are so many immigrants.
Who are and using because of the this, yes, National Health Service.
Yes. Mm. If you are a country like ours, we are 50 million. If you invite another 20 million, if they're 50, in Dar we are 5 million, the traffic is where it is. When you are extra three uninvited. Yes. Yeah, so these things will happen. And you have seen it in South Africa. Why do you think there is xenophobia? Yes, we fought, we supported South Africa, but they will tell you, you are stealing our jobs. You are stealing our women. We don't want you here. So this, you know, we cannot avoid this. It will happen anywhere. The question is, are we ready to take the cost?
Are we ready to manage the consequences?
Cost. Yes. The consequences. Just to put a number on the EU workers in UK, there are about 2.5 million people who are from outside UK in the, you know, who are working in the UK. So the question of this perception, they are taking our jobs, putting a number, it's a huge number.
This impact of disintegration on the East African region. Britain itself, this is the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland.
Yes.
The Scots are already saying, they need another referendum now that Britain has broken away from Europe. What about the Scottish future? And the Scottish Prime Minister has stayed behind, has been in Brussels negotiating.
Nicola Sturgeon.
She has been negotiating the interests of Scotland alone. Northern Ireland, the Irish Republic at Army, is up again. They say, freedom for, because the Brits themselves, they said, this is Independence Day. This is what they announced, the exit vote. This is independence for Britain.
And those who were saying
And then the Scots heard that and said,
But those who are calling Independence Day have since stepped down, have since resigned. Nigel Farage.
Boris Johnson. It's a Pandora's box that they have opened and nobody is able or willing to handle the consequences. That, I think, is the problem that faces Britain.
I think a broader implication or lesson for us, I think. I know you wanted at the end we summarize on the lesson. But I think what Mgambo was saying is that as we move in a union, in a common market, whether SADC or EAC, I think making calculated moves on what does it mean to the common man and woman is so critical. Because if you don't handle that carefully, the consequences of any vote later is what we are seeing now in UK. But I see maybe taking a step back, the long term, there are short term and the long term consequences. The short term, which even the common man in the streets is asking, what does it mean? Bona sielewi, I don't understand, what does it mean to us? I think for a common person, first of all, the complete exit will be in 2 years' time. If the process takes. But the immediate effect to me, there's what I call a neutral for the common man. For the Tanzanian, there was no moving, wanting to go to UK. You needed a different visa to UK, different visa to European Union. So if you get a Schengen visa, does not automatically allow you to go to you. So there's no difference there. Yeah? You still need to have two visas. But maybe the positive part of it, out of the immediate consequences, because of the shock, the pressure on the sterling pound, it means its value has gone down. Certain percentage, at least I don't know whether it has recovered. I haven't checked for the last two days, but it has been under pressure. So what does it mean? It means actually for exporters, Tanzanian exporters, and for Tanzania actually we export most of our agricultural commodities, coffee, tea. It means actually our farmers will have like field day celebrating. They will be getting more money now, in the short run. As the sterling pound weakens, so there's more money to make for our exporters. Mm. But for those who and who import, actually, it will also mean that they it's cheaper to import.
So from the UK,
from the UK, UK. You know, no, actually, Tanzania among the European countries, UK is the largest trading partner with Tanzania. The same even for Kenya.
Yeah.
So now Kenyan flour exporters to London, they will be getting more money because of that. But once the economy stabilizes, I think that's those who are the pro exit campaign. We are saying yes, there will be immediate short term impact that the economy will get a shock. But the long term, I think that's what the exit group was campaigning, that after some time, we shall emerge, the economy will emerge stronger. Stronger in the sense that the vestiges of tentacles of businesses, British businesses all over the world. And since they had that colonial connection with most of the Commonwealth countries, I could see most of the trade arrangements between Tanzania and UK, Tanzania, Kenya and UK, they'll not necessarily need to be renegotiated because they were there before. So we'll just revise. There have been some bilateral sort of trade. Most of the agreements in trading, they have been bilateral. And then you had the advantage we had was that under European Union umbrella for negotiation, you have one agreement for exporting, which wasn't much for us because they are still actually, that's another aspect, because we have been negotiating for us to have access for value-added goods. Our entry to the European market so far was restricted to raw materials, and they have been complaining. We wanted the market to allow us export finished agricultural goods. That business for negotiation has not been completed yet. So it won't make much difference for us. It might also just give us the resolve now to navigate more newer markets in the Asian markets, China, India, etc. So
a bit of a condition for what he said, that weaker pound may lead to more export. It's true. But then it depends from economics, the ceteris paribus condition, all other things remaining constant. Mm-hmm. Because with the weaker pound, yes, more export, theoretically. But then this depends on the existing demand in the UK. Because again, as you have said, this uncertainty, all these moves in the market, if they will lead to loss of jobs and loss of incomes, then demand might not be there. If again they lead to uncertainty of saying, well, we are not sure how the whole story will be unfolding, and people become more cautious on spending, then we may also see spending going down. We saw this in 2008 with the weaker dollar. Economic theory will tell you with the weaker currency, the US dollar, for example, in 2008, we thought that we could export more and more and more. But actually, we could not, because although the currencies were weaker, but then people had no money in their pockets. People were bankrupt. So it will depend really how it plays out at the end of the day.
Yes, Professor.
Yes, I just wanted to comment on this point, because I think there's a lot of economics, which is fine. But I think these unions, these cooperation agreements, are basically essentially political, it looks to me. And now, of course, the European Union looks like an economic organization, but the underlying forces that created the union, starting with the European Coal and Steel Community, which basically linked the production of military equipment between France and Germany. They said they have to control this centrally, so that they don't continue to manufacture weapons to kill each other. That is the foundation of the European Union. Now, the extent to which it is still driven by that original idea, what I call imperatives, then we'll decide exactly what the impact will be, even on the European Union itself. There are arguments that it is tending now that the reactions, one of the reactions is that there are countries now demanding also new referenda within the Union itself. But also there are countries that have become even more European. I understand the Nordic countries, etc. They've become more European. The key to this, is that it depends on the imperative that drives particular countries to join others in this organization. And there are imperatives that come out of necessity. Mm. And there are those that come out of choice, the idea that you may choose to go in or out.
Choose to come out, yes.
One, in, on the side of choice, people say, okay, because I love you, I like you, and that's the minute we don't like each other, mm. I walk out on this relationship. The other one is gain, that it's because I can get some economic gain, etc. And when things go wrong, I'll walk out. But on the necessity side, and I think which is what binds the Europeans together, may bring them closer, even closer together, the issue of security. European security, both economic and military, social security, that is the bound, that is the glue, in my view, that has maintained and sustained these organizations, as long as they are aware that it's not because they love each other, it's not because they have some economic gain, but because it is necessary for them to bind together, then they will stay together. And I think that's the lesson that East Africa, SADC, SACO, that's the lesson we should draw. Mm. Are you in for the short term? Okay. Or are you in, as they say, even marriages break down, but they say through thick and thin, when in wellness and in sickness. But of course, marriages break down.
You have a lot of divorces.
That's why I think I prefer arranged marriages, because necessity keeps you there.
And the cultural
not,
bound.
Not choice.
Richard.
Yes.
So do you think, is leaving the European Union good or bad for the UK? And do you think the European Union will remain the same after this development?
This is something very complicated. Let me tell you something very, very important to understand here. It depends who you ask that questions. If you ask the Yes campaign, they'll give you what they think is the right. If you ask the No campaign, they'll give you what happens. But for some of us here, UK has been going through a lot of economic problems for the past 20 years. If I ask you where you are, when was the last time you bought a product from UK in your house?
Made in England.
The day before, two days ago.
Even the Jag, which is the Jaguar, that company was bought by the Indian.
By Tata, yeah.
So the point here is, if it was for good, what we are seeing right now means it wasn't for good. And for those who know Boris, the journalist, whose all articles when he was at Brussels was writing against the EU.
That's Boris Johnson.
And this is where the media now, when the media can manipulate the public opinion, because what happened in the UK is the media manipulated the public opinion. The media made people believe that if you vote this way, all our problems, the next morning, NHS will be fine.
Agenda.
But think along these lines. It is too expensive. Yes. To join university in UK in terms of school fees than anywhere in Europe. Yeah. Is this going to sort it out? The tuition fee in UK is the most expensive in Europe. It is too expensive to buy a pair of clothes made in Britain than to buy the same pair made in Sweden. So again, it's a very simple but also complicated. Whether it is for good or for bad, we are already seeing the worst case scenario. Maybe it's for short run. For long run, they'll tell you we will emerge. We are United Kingdom. But again, when Scotland demand a second referendum because they want to remain within EU, and you have Northern Ireland demanding the same.
And they want to join.
What if London also demand the same?
Republic of Ireland.
Yeah.
So to me, I think time will tell whether the Yes campaign did the right thing for their country as they claimed or not.
But when you have, gentlemen, when you have over 4,000 signatories from British
four million
people signatures saying there must be a rerun because they don't believe the vote leave will bring the benefits they wanted. What do you say to that?
They think there was a rigging.
Yes.
They think there was rigging like we do here.
But there was no rigging.
Yeah.
It was a clear, I think, democratic way of deciding things.
I think it was 52%. A clear thing. Yeah. But yes, I think what might have driven the British the way they did is the question that we also have problems here, the question of leadership, political leadership. The ability to stand up and defend a cause effectively, because I think the Prime Minister used this referendum about Europe so just to gain political advantage during the elections. And then it became a promise that he had made. So by the time he goes to this referendum, he's not sure, he was unwilling actually to go to the referendum. Mm. But having committed himself
to the campaign, for okay, the election.
So he locked himself in into that situation. So he went into this thing knowing fairly well, very well, and of course the polls were saying that it was neck to neck, but also tilting it towards the exit lobby. So I think everybody now in Britain, I don't know what's going to happen within the Labour Party, I don't know what's going to happen in the Conservative Party.
Although Theresa May, the leading contender, but she was on the leave, on the remaining.
She was on the remaining
side. She's leading now by 169.
You see, and of course, the British Prime Minister is resigned because he said it would be dishonest for him to be able to drive the country towards the exit side when he was the remain side. That should be the challenge for Theresa May as well.
Yeah.
Can she honestly do that thing? I think they may have to rethink the whole thing. I don't know how they are going to do it.
And I think you talked about the timing. Yes. I think that the timing also, maybe Mugabe is saying maybe they couldn't come in even a better timing given the deterioration of the role of the British economy vis-a-vis the rest of the European Union. But the timing with respect to movement of people, the mass movement, the migration coming from Eastern Europe and Asia and Africa, getting into Europe, and the European countries putting pressure on UK that you must also accept
more
to increase the quota of people allowed. And yet, you know, internally there's even people are dissatisfied with the number they already have. So if now for you to agree to go for a referendum, or even to put that as part of a political campaign, when I think it was a bad move on his part.
Exactly.
It's also so racist, by the way. We should also bring this point forward, because I think what you're saying, our people who are our sons and daughters in London Edinburgh and other places, they are going to go through a very hard period of this exit, because it's not going to stop with exit Europe. It means now the next thing is those people who are immigrants inside England, Britain, out.
All those from the outside.
All those. And when it comes to lack of jobs, etc., they are going to be the first ones to lose jobs.
Somewhere we talked about the lessons learned. Mm-hmm. And I think in the context of regional integration, really it tells us these integrations really have to be people-centered, you know. Mm-hmm. They should not be, kind of based in Brussels, but really it should be in-depth from people. Maybe if the Leave campaigners believed that the union is ours, we are benefiting, we are getting what we want to get, maybe it won't be all here. But then I think there is this feeling that it is Janka out there who is manipulating and ruling each and everything. So for our relatively very infant unions, East African Community, SADC and all this, really if these things are not deep-rooted in people, if they are kind of driven by leaders, for example, there was this talk of a political federation, and some people think it's because somebody out there wants to be the first president in South Africa. That is very wrong. It has to come from the people.
Okay, all right.
What professor is raising here is any union, the so-called SADC, EAC, it's about stomach. It's about the common person on the street.
Yes.
If you lecture me about East African Community, which is funded by the donors by almost 90%. Look at African Union. The headquarters was built by aid from China.
By the Chinese.
Most of the members, the countries, have never paid their fee for the past 20 years. Now, do you claim to have legitimacy in that union? So again, if you are not thinking about a common man on the street, if you are going to join the East African Community, are you thinking about Tanzanians or you are thinking about diplomatic status quo? If you don't put forward the interest of your people, the very same people will push you one day that we want to go out, or else we don't give you vote. That's what happened to David Cameron. He has no choice. So to me, I still remember what Moi told the East African leaders in 1990s. He said, economies is about the stomach. If someone has no food on the table, and then I see foreigners in my country having food on the table, I will start thinking that something is wrong. Because remember, this someone is illiterate. There are so many illiterates in UK who think that they are what they are because of you and I, if we are there as foreigners.
But they can also scapegoating. Of course, they look for scapegoats in foreigners. I mean, the foreigners become the cause of all the problems
we know it even here.
That may have. But also, you want to consider the options and the consequences of the options you choose, because are you going to be better off?
That's the question.
even as you throw off the yoke of the European Union, are you going to be better off, or could you indeed be worse off?
By moving out or by rejecting?
Yeah, by moving out. And I think the signals are, I think everybody's agreed, I think most people in Britain, when this thing is over, after you have this feeling after the elections, and you are all excited, and then it subsides, and then you begin to see the reality. And I think now the British are really being able to study carefully what this means. Is it implementable? I mean, you have, if you say you have 2 years in which they have to trigger Article 50, what you're talking about is 2 years of uncertainty. I mean, the issue that we raised about, nobody knows, what's going to happen. They are supposed to negotiate a new arrangement. It's like you have a divorce, but then you can meet occasionally, with...
But German is adamant, doesn't want that.
They want them to exit as well as and I'm just possible.
And I'm just wondering, by the way, to what extent could this be the beginning of a real rupture in Europe, which may bring up all these ethnic differences between the Germans, the French, the British, the kind of situation that has brought two wars, one for the First World War and the Second World War. I'm just wondering. Yeah. I hope it doesn't happen.
My follow-up question on that. Do you think what has happened will lead into the disintegration of Europe in the first place? Secondly, disintegration of Great Britain as we know it, because if Scotland said yes to remain, Northern Ireland said yes to remain, and they eventually wanted to join the Republic, Scotland wants to remain independent, and if you negotiate to go in, I mean, what will happen? Will the European Union remain the same, or it will disintegrate? Will the UK, United Kingdom, remain the same?
I don't think anybody really sat down to work out the repercussions in the short term, in the medium term, or even in the long term. But I think what we see right now is basically a mixture of all these outcomes. On the one hand, you have these people who Europe maybe that is European, because you mentioned the idea that Britain being an island, and having that insular mentality. That may bring Europe together, closer together between themselves. That could mean that they survive. And of course, they have expanded the European Union by about more than 100% in very few years. Very few years with these new countries which came in. And those new countries don't know whether to have referenda in their own countries or not. But my own prediction is that probably this Britain, Germany, France, who are the founders of this European Union, I think as long as they stay together on the basis of the mutual peace and security, because as I say, the foundation was to stop any other war in future between European countries. If they have that kind of historical memory, maybe.
Without UK, who will stop Russia? Look at EU.
Yes.
In terms of security, EU will not be the same. UK has always been a very active member when it comes to international politics, international security.
Yeah.
Now, you have seen what has been happening in between Russia and their neighbors. and who was the powerful person or leader who can condemn what these guys were doing. Now, without UK,
yeah.
Germany, France,
yeah.
would they have a stronger terms to contain guys like Vladimir Putin?
It looks to me, and this is maybe what is happening now is a reflection of these changes in the geopolitical landscape of Europe, that Britain has been weakening over the years. And Germany has been getting stronger. Mm-hmm. And I think part of the reason that Britain decides to exit is because of that. That the Germans are getting more and more dominant.
Economically?
Yeah. And therefore right. also having a stronger political muscle. Mm-hmm. And demanding that on the basis of the kind of economic hegemony they are able to impose upon the rest of the European. The British are walking out because to challenge in a way this resurgence of the Germans, and I don't know whether there are fears of this Germany being. People have memories of Hitler and
Germany as Germans as maybe not so reliable in this situation. So
I think it's a mixture of things which I think will begin to unfold.
Adam, I see that perhaps the presence. The changes which has occurred in the past 20 years, whereby actually most of the British, so-called British, original British companies are no longer British, they are international. And there are still, of course, some of them based in UK. I think they will have, I'm sure they will spare no stone unturned to make sure that the West scenario doesn't happen in terms of a relationship between the UK and
relocating from London. They're going to be relocated to Paris and other European capitals. Some of these companies have said so.
And I'm sure they'll...
British companies.
The British, but what I was trying to hypothesize here is that perhaps those companies will start play an active part in making sure that those two, the island and the mainland, don't really move past their parts. They'll continue having some sense of ties because it's good for their business as well to continue having access to the British market.
Yeah.
Of course, they are eyeing for the larger European market. Yes. The British market is smaller, although it's in terms of contribution to the EU budget, for example, it's 22% of the budget that is coming from UK. It is a contribution by United Kingdom. But in terms of overall purchasing power and market, it's also...
Europe combined.
It's Europe combined. So I think those multinationals will make sure, you know, now politics and business, they go hand in hand. So I'm sure they'll work overtime to make sure that things don't fall apart.
They clean up the mess that has been made by the politicians.
I read we don't have a legal representative here, but I read somewhere where some constitutional experts were saying at the end of it all, Britain may not succeed in exiting the European Union. They are citing a number of issues.
Mm-hmm.
First, the vote difference itself.
Mm-hmm.
And then they are saying, because of the issue you are talking about, this European investment in Europe, and the fact that London, the major financial center, in the world, voted no. So they're arguing that it may not be possible. And again, I also read that some constitutional lawyers are coming together to try and take this matter to the court. So do you think Britain will succeed?
Well, I'm not anywhere close to a lawyer. I think civilized that they seem to be. They'll respect people's voices. The people have spoken, and I believe their voices will be heard. And you could see even within the EU now, I think they want UK to exit as early as yesterday. You know, just looking at the voices that are coming is, yes, this is how you have voted, please trigger Article 50 as early as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And what the businesses want, partly again what Dr. Nogelo is saying, I think what businesses want is let Article 50 be triggered as early as possible so that we are now clear that we are out and that's it. And you could see Business, you know, we are saying capital is very fluid, is very mobile. They are not really, or should I say, they are not so much in need of staying in London. Of course, they would have loved to stay there, but we have seen some now moving to Frankfurt, some moving to France, and actually
moved
some
to Zurich.
Sorry, yeah. Yeah, and some even some Asian companies going back to Asia, because what they are saying is, under globalization, you don't need necessarily to stay in London in order to trade with London. So, I'm not really sure whether you know, my belief is, you know, it will be respected. People's voices will be respected. Otherwise, I think it will be very awkward.
I think the question was, what about the structural constraints? Mm-hmm. Can they actually, given these connections that are on the ground, and that is actually going to be the last line of confrontation, because the French foreign minister was saying, this relationship which Britain is trying to negotiate is just not possible. Mm. You are in or out.
Actually, what Angela Merkel told the German lady, she told Britain, you cannot kind of pick the good things and demand them cherry pick. That was the way actually I was going for. You cannot cherry pick. You are either outside or inside.
Human nature.
Yeah.
Once you divorce your wife,
then she becomes nicer.
Or your husband says no. or husband.
The following day, you discover that she was actually the most beautiful woman.
You are either in or out.
Okay, time. We have 10 minutes. Let's go to the last question. So, all what we have discussed here, with the various scenarios happening in Britain, in what the British people have decided, what is it that Tanzania, the United Republic of Tanzania, should start thinking in terms of the implications? You started earlier saying, and you reported it, in terms of the financial implications, the importation, the exports, on the economic front. Perhaps not so much on the political front, which is yet very volatile now in the UK. So, is there one or two specific lessons that you wanted to emphasize today in the next 5 minutes, so that the powers that be can hear? And we start getting ready ourselves.
Well,
Professor,
my view...
As a political scientist.
Yes, okay. My view is that, first of all, I think strategically, my own thinking is that Tanzania, like all these other countries of ours, I think the first lesson to draw from this is really the drive for self-reliance, for really not depending, because it's so unpredictable out there.
Yes.
And I don't know how much money Britain had committed to our the foreign aid basket. And how much of that is being driven through the European Union, whether they will pull it out and then dish it out themselves, it's not entirely clear what's happening. So, but the first lesson that we should learn is the essence of being able to be self-reliant, to have an economy, as we move forward, just to be able to say, we make the decisions and we found with our own money.
Okay. I think let me share a peek. The good lessons for the East African community and SADC. I would call upon our policy makers, our politicians, to take it very seriously, the issue of trying to make sure that this union we're talking about, East African community or SADC, benefits the common man, the common trader, the farmers. Let our farmers, traders trade freely within East Africa. Let them take goods and sell the other side of the border without restriction. Then they see there's a benefit for that. So one day if there's a politician who says, let's vote for or against the East African community, they will be in favor of the community because they know they are benefiting from it.
All right.
I think I will go back to my earlier comments. The lesson that we learned, normally, I avoid talking about aid because I've never believed in aid.
It's
the lesson that I see here that our leaders and those who will be watching this program is, in any union, you have to review that union to see whether you are meeting the common goals. And the common goal is the common man. We have the union between Tanganyika and Zanzibar, which has given us United Republic of Tanzania. We have the SADC. It started as a front liberation movement for the Southern African countries. Now we are told, I'm not quite sure, is a regional integration system is taking place. It may take another 30 years, I don't know. We have East African Community, we have African Union, by the way. So at the end of the day, we should listen to our people, what they want, because these are the people we claim to save, and these are the people we claim to unite. It doesn't make sense if when I export maize to Kenya, there are so many obstacles than exporting the same maize to Europe. So we need to be extra careful. That.
You want us to start with giving them the constitution that they made for themselves.
Yeah.
Constitution, public.
I think the background here really is really having people-centered regional integration at the end of the day. And, of course, understanding the dynamics of all these integrations, again, the global economy is highly interlinked. Because I've heard some political leaders saying, all these things will not affect us. And I heard this again 2008. People are saying it is taking place far from here. When the big man gets problem, there is no way we cannot be affected, whether through trade or aid that my friends do not like. I do not like it either, or through all these financial services.
Globalization is still there.
Yeah,
it died.
Exactly. Sorry.
All right. Okay. Well.
Utandawizi.
Utandawizi. Well, thank you very much, my panelists, for your excellent contribution and views about the Britain. Not entirely Britain, but probably the English wanting to leave the European Union, which they joined in 1973, and it's a long time ago, with all the benefits or disadvantages notwithstanding. And as you rightly said, Tanzania for that matter, and probably Africa, there are lessons to be learned on from this development. As the British themselves are learning now that maybe they made a wrong decision because of the uncertainty that has grown up, maybe the value of the pound and probably the anticipated loss in their own income, savings, they can't travel that much to Europe, and all that. But then there's also a feeling somewhere that maybe this exit will not succeed because, after all, Britain has to initiate Article 50 of the Lisbon, what they call Lisbon Treaty of the Union, for them to start the process of exiting practically and physically.
And formally.
And formally. So, viewers, as we've heard from my panel this year, those are the views, and we did a justice to this discussion. Let us hope the powers that be, when those who are going to watch this program, who have read the views of my panelists here, and take the necessary steps when and as they consider the relevant policy responses. That's it for us today. Until next Sunday at 21 hours, the repeat program on Thursday at 15 hours. On behalf of my panel, Richard Mgamba, Professor Ngowi, Professor Baregu, Dr. Lunagero, and my TBC Television Center crew. Thank you, viewers, and goodbye. Mm-hmm.